Friends, and welcome to the Seiker Podcast, that service of change where we challenge reality, question that which we've been taught in hopes of inspiring a new direction of thought to bring about change. I'm your host, Dennis Nappy II, with Service of Change, where you can read my book, I Am Human and We Are Not Who We Think We Are, for free at serviceofchange.com/I Am Human. I'd love it if you checked it out. Subscribe to the Seiker newsletter. You can read the book for free. The newsletter comes out just about every week with highlights from each week's podcast and some exclusive content and thoughts from me reflecting on things. You also get various discounts and things to the Service of Change bookstore. Everything through serviceofchange.com. Many ways to listen to the show. You can listen on iTunes, you can listen on YouTube, you can listen on SoundCloud, and through the Service of Change app. You can all get through the show notes at serviceofchange.com. Let me jump into this show today. I want to talk about life after death. It's something that probably everybody has thought about at some point in our existence. Whether that thought has just been, well, I think once we're dead, that's it. There's no life after death. And beyond, we have various belief systems that we, that run through this planet that we live on, this existence that we call life. So earlier this week, I finished reading, it was actually the audiobook version of Robert Monroe's final book, The Ultimate Journey. Now, those of you that have been following the show and listen to the things that I've spoken about, obviously I'm a fan of Robert Monroe and the work that he's done, that he's pioneered really through the institute he founded called the Monroe Institute, which basically explores consciousness. And he's found a way to generate repeatable results in the exploration of consciousness. And he has a technology called hemisync technology, which is through the use of, I can't explain as well as the Institute can, obviously, but binaural beats, which plays one tone in one ear and a slightly different tone in another ear, and it creates a waveform, basically, that meets in the center of your brain. And those different frequencies of waveforms will induce altered states of consciousness. It's most popularly known for the out-of-body experience that they're able to induce in many of the participants that go through the different training programs that they have there at the Monroe Institute. Now, a little backstory here. When I was about 16 or 17 years old, this is how far when my journey really started getting going. I was having experiences. This is kind of part of the stuff that feeds into, the next book that's coming out from me, Food for the Archons. I would have those typical experiences that people report. I don't know if they're typical, but you wake up and you're in a state of paralysis. And if that's not scary enough where you're going, I'm wide awake, I can hear the TV playing, or I can hear whatever sounds are normal in my home right now, but I can't move. And then all of a sudden, out of your periphery, or you just feel it, or you sense a presence in the room. Now, I've had this happen several times. I've had that sensation of, oh my gosh, there's a shadow in the room. It's gone further. I've heard, that shadow has approached me. It's put hands on me. That's a topic for another day. Things I've talked about in my podcast about the documentary, The Nightmare. But I've encountered stuff while I'm fully conscious, fully aware, again, hearing the normal sounds, and then there's something else in the room. So, I had an interest in this topic and consciousness and spirituality and hey, there's got to be something more going on. And I came across a book, my mother gave it to me, called Cosmic Voyage by Dr. Courtney Brown. And Courtney Brown is a remote viewer. He's founded the Faber Institute, which is located out of, I forget which county, but it's in Georgia. not the Faber Institute, the Farsight Institute, forgive me. And this is where they do, you know, remote viewing sessions on any variety of topics, from hard, tangible, verifiable targets that they'll look at to abstract topics, you know, like UFOs and extraterrestrials and life on other planets. So check it out, Farsight Institute. But my point is, as he was learning how to do remote viewing, which is basically a way to psychically view any place or any time. Again, they get verifiable results as well with the things that they do. As a part of his training, he referenced going through the Monroe Institute, where he learned a little bit more about how to expand your consciousness. So I took an interest in Robert Monroe and his work way back when I was 16 years old, and it's come up in all the research I've been doing into this time and time again, because they're doing really good stuff that I think, on a personal note, the things that they teach and have available through the Monroe Institute, I think should be taught in every school around the world, because it will give us a better sense of who we are. And that is one of my main goals as an author and as a podcast host, as a writer, is to expand our understanding or our at least generate the question of who are we? Because there's more to us. I can say that with confidence, with the evidence that I've uncovered, that I've come across, that I'm compiling in my book, Food for the Archons. We are capable of so much more that I'm barely scratching the surface with these podcasts that I get into. But I hope they give you, some kind of direction, something to look into. I hope it sparks an interest in you. So the work at the Monroe Institute, Robert Monroe found out back, I want to say in the 50s or 60s, that he was waking up looking down at his body. So he'd be basically floating on the ceiling staring at his body. And he was going, whoa, what's wrong with me? Got all sorts of medical tests and find out he was actually very healthy, had a clean bill of health. So we started exploring this further. He also owned, I think, some radio stations or whatever. And with the work of a team that he assembled in his research and development, they came up with this technology that would allow this state, this out-of-body state, to be induced in people. So you're able to leave your body. And what they did was they went out and they explored. And, what is this state? What can we do with this state? And if you go to their website, the Monroe Institute, just Google it. They have the Explorer series, and it's a bunch of the old tapes of people when they were first going out and trying to explore, what is this? What is this world that's out there? And they were finding some really interesting things. They were encountering other intelligences that were out there as well. So I just finished reading his third book called Ultimate Journey. It's his final book, and it talks about, where is all of this leading? And it talked a lot about him trying to find his purpose in life and life after death. And one of the things that he was sure of was that life continues on once the physical body dies. One of his mantras that he puts out there is, I am more than just a physical body. And this has kind of been the driving force in his work. And what he states in his books is that if you go through some of the training programs at the Monroe Institute, you will know that life continues on, that you continue on beyond physical death. So in his book, he's talking about how he's pushing it, and he's pushing the boundaries and going into all these different states of consciousness. And there's multiple states. They call them, focus levels. Focus 10, for example, is your mind's awake and your body's asleep. And then it moves on. I think there's a focus 12, a focus 15. And so they go all the way up, and each one brings you to different spots. There's one state where it's timeless. You could feel like you're gone for hours and hours and hours, and really only about a minute has passed in our physical waking reality. So a lot of fascinating stuff in there. In this journey that he went on, he started looking for people that had passed on, and one of the things that he started doing. He was kind of led to that he'd get this, when he was out of his body, he'd get this pull to go to a certain location or a certain time period, and he'd end up finding somebody who was totally confused and upset. And what he was realizing was these people had just died. So then he would take that person and follow his intuition, his inner beacon, and say, come with me, I can take you where you need to go. And he would start traveling with them off towards whatever his next destination was. And he identified certain levels that were what he referred to as where the belief system frequency was, basically. I don't, those aren't his exact words, but, and he said that a lot of times as he was passing through these frequencies, the person he was escorting that had just died would then disappear. And he later learned that, well, when somebody reaches those belief systems, if that is their common held belief, they get welcomed by somebody, a representative of that belief system, to bring them into it. And it got me thinking about some of the older books I read, you know, when I first started studying, you know, pagan spirituality. And it talked a lot about the power of belief, and other studies I've looked at as well, talking about the power of consciousness. We are conscious creators. We have the power to create things with our minds. And in this aspect, I think there's a lot that has been created through our own beliefs. And according to what Monroe has encountered, if, let's say that you're a Christian and you believe in heaven, when you die, because consciously so many people have devoted energy to the belief in heaven, there will be some type of heavenly existence and someone there to guide you through that transition process that mostly resembles your belief system. But that's not the only thing out there. There are multiple belief systems, and there's other places where if you don't have a belief system, which I think if I interpreted the book correctly, Monroe believed that to be more in tune with reality than a belief system, which is a product of human creation. You get absorbed into these different areas for your transition process. So what he was finding was that there is life after death, and that certain people are able to help you transition through that. Now, I know Tom Campbell, I believe is his name, author of My Big Toe, who is also kind of like a co-founder with Bob Monroe, at least a big major researcher. He's a NASA scientist as well, NASA physicist. You know, he does this as well. What happened was, after Monroe had all of these experiences, he created a system, which is now called the Lifeline. It's called Lifeline. It's a training course through Monroe Institute where you will be taught these different levels of consciousness. You'll explore the belief systems that are out there and how to access them to see, you know, to bring people there. And basically you're taught how to go meet somebody at the point of death, right when they die, right when they transition, and help guide them to wherever it is that they need to go. Now that is fascinating. That there are living human beings who are able to alter their state of consciousness to escort someone who recently passed on to their next level in the other world. And he's got a whole program dedicated to this. And in his book, he talks about the statistics of you know, the success rates of this program. And obviously, this program is still going on, I guess 20 years later now, at least with, you know, with these results that people are getting. I think in some cases, now again, the book was 1995, I think it came out, where they had some times where they were able to verify some of the information. I don't know what results they've gotten since then by getting the person's name and place of origin and stuff. But, you know, with the results they're getting, you know, here, it seems like a pretty successful program. And I'm just so taken by it. And really, once I finished reading that final book, I just had to shut my brain down for a while to try to absorb the power of what he was talking about, because that really changes just about everything we know. We think, you know, in this existence, a lot of us feel that there's a higher power, a higher God that is judging us and passing judgment on us. And according to the experiences that Monroe and others like him have had, that's not necessarily the case. And he almost makes an argument that we are here to do certain things in order to acquire a certain level of knowledge, you know, based on our experiences here as human beings. You know, which at the end, like I said, at the end of the day, there's no judgment based upon that, those actions that we take. So what got me thinking, though, really I keep coming back to, and again, if you listen to the show, you know, ever since my father passed, I've really been looking hard into this. You know, I wonder if there was something negative that was affecting my father as he was trying to transition, because it was such a bad process. And maybe it was more traumatic for me to watch, but I don't know. My father fought it every step of the way. You know, it was a horrible, horrible transition for me, passed of cancer back in 2013. And in Monroe's second book, he talks about basically creation was, you know, this creation was for the generation of an energy called Lush, which is a, you know, some form of sustenance that some of these other beings in the other worlds, I guess, use for energy or nourishment. And that Lush is created from human suffering, human fear, human sadness, human loneliness. And it made it sound like, hey, this earth is one big Lush farm. You know, and I did a whole show dedicated to this. You know, look back on the YouTube page. I think it's in those archives or on serviceofchange.com. You can find it. And I found other authors that have talked about stuff like this. Carlos Castaneda talked about, you know, the predator that lives among us that feeds off of human energy. The Gnostic writings, you know, talk about the archons, the archontic force that, again, feeds off of human energy. So in a way, Monroe's information kind of verified some of these much older texts and works and stories that there is some kind of parasite out there that feeds off of, you know, negative human energy. And some will make the argument that they induce those things in us. So what happens when we die? You know, I highly recommend you read Robert Monroe's book, Ultimate Journey. He gives a lot of good insight into it. I don't know for sure. I know what I've read, but I don't have any direct experience with anything on that realm. I'd like to. I hope someday I make it to the Monroe Institute. That's definitely a goal of mine. You know, we'll see. We'll see where it goes to, though. You know, but I'm also reminded of, you know, recently I was talking about a book by Paul Rademacher, which was called The Spiritual Hitchhiker's Guide to the Universe. Now, Paul is a former director of the Monroe Institute. A few years back, he left the Institute. There's a video online of Paul talking about one of his first experiences at the Institute where he was, you know, he leaves his body and he was brought over to, I guess, a group of, he called them, I guess, beings of light. I don't remember how he referred to them, but they were standing around another person as that person was dying. And he came over to help. And what he realized was that that person that had just died was his father. And he was able to help his father in that transition process. And I'll see if I can find the video and leave it in the show notes. But listening to him talk about that was really, it resonates with me, obviously, because of what I'm going through or what I went through, what I'm still trying to figure out with the loss of my father. So I guess my point in this whole podcast is there's information to be had. There's experience to be had through the Monroe Institute and some of these training programs that they offer that I think can give us some of the answers that we're constantly searching for. This is why some wars are fought over belief systems, and this here is a potential answer. Some people may say we're not meant to know. I completely disagree, and I think there's thousands of people who have been through the Monroe Institute's training program that would also take that same stance. We're meant to evolve. We're meant to understand this consciousness. And what has happened is we have forgotten who we are. And we have forgotten our connection and our ability to connect to something much greater than let me turn on the news and see what the latest tragedy is today. Or let me look at Facebook and see what's coming across my feed. We have unlimited potential. And we have forgotten how to use it. Again, in Food for the Archons, I spell this out quite well as far as some of the connections that we have and research that verifies that, yes, this is a real phenomenon. And so I hope that you'll check it out. I hope you'll subscribe to my newsletter, the Seeker newsletter through serviceofchange.com, to stay connected to get the updates when the book is going to be ready and available, because I'd love for everybody to read it and share the word. But I'm going to cut this podcast off here because we are out of time. I've gone a little bit over my limit here. But again, check out Ultimate Journey by Robert Monroe. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. What happens when we die? What research do you have? And if you have anything, any type of information that you can send me about the archons, about energy parasites, about anything about Lush. I've reached out to a couple people who've been through the Monroe Institute for some more information on Lush. I've gotten a little bit, but I can't seem to find too much more on it. So I'm actively searching for more information on that experience and that particular subject. If you have it, I'd love to hear about it. Please send it my way. All my contact information is at serviceofchange.com. You can find it. Just hit the contact tab. You can send me a note. And also in the show notes, there's a spot as well. So that's all the time I have. I'm Dennis Nappy II with Service of Change, where small changes among the masses can have a massive impact around the world. I encourage you to be that change, never stop questioning, and keep an open mind. Thank you.
Welcome to Truth Seekers.